right. Hello, everyone. Thanks for coming. I don't know if there's any more chairs, but...
Sorry.
People in the back, sorry if you need to stand, but I guess that's the case usually. Thanks for coming to the San Francisco Bitcoin Meetup again. And I guess we're just going to start it off with our first presenter tonight. This is going to be Angela Keaton from antiwar.com, and her talk is called In the Battle Between the FBI and Antiwar.com, Bitcoin Wins.
Thank you, Paige, and thank you guys for inviting us out here tonight. I work for antiwar.com, which is a website that's a,
both a news aggregator and has lots of opinion editorials on U.S. foreign policy. We collect news stories every day, and we try to run op-eds that are, they always lean anti-intervention. We're pretty clear about our editorial bias right up front. It's antiwar.com. But also, with all those editorials, there's about 100 news items every day from things going on all over the world. We kind of focus on primarily U.S. foreign policy. Our attitude toward it is, we've got a pretty poor attitude towards U.S. foreign policy. I didn't think that would be too controversial a statement in this room, but, you know, in the battle, you know, why Bitcoin? And this is not going to be a technical discussion. I don't care what the magic elves do with the blockchains. I'm just glad that the rest of you are all taking care of that for me. And we're not a libertarian website. We're a site staffed by libertarians. And that's a distinction because we really, what's important to us with the anti-war effort is that we build a coalition. And on our page, the running gag is, you know, on any given day, you'll see Noam Chomsky right alongside Pat Buchanan and everything in between and around. It's not, we're not trying to create libertarians, we're trying to stop an aggressive U.S. foreign policy. So that's really kind of our focus there. But because it is staffed by libertarians, and libertarians of a certain unusual culture that tends to be extremely obsessive and early adopters with any kind of technology, no matter what it is, no matter how wacky it sounds. And I can remember in my inbox in 2011, some of our freakier readers saying, when are you gonna take Bitcoin? Like, oh God, here it comes. You know, the newest thing, the latest thing, and you get cynical about all the newest, latest projects. And in fact, being sort of a more traditional kind of libertarian, I'm kind of an old school gold standard type. I call it Bitcoin, then shitcoin. You know, that was usually when here comes a shitcoin. But you know, once I got past that in my head, people who eventually became Bitcoin, not bombs, finally did a really good arm twist on, you gotta do this. You've got to take Bitcoin. Now, something happened that was pretty important in 2012 to antiwar.com. It's actually a rather long story, so I'll try to really kind of keep it quick. In the fall of 2011, in August of 2011, antiwar.com became aware of the fact that at some point we had been the subject of an FBI surveillance, an FBI monitoring. We, of course, did not realize how far it went at the time, but someone had uploaded a script file and read it, and then called my boss and said, you realize there's 20 pages in this Somebody's Freedom of Information Request Act, and it was on some issue ancillary to 9/11, about 100 pages long, and 20 pages of that was about antiwar.com. Well, we were shocked, and in it we learned that there was a preliminary investigation that began under FISA, which is the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act, and talks quite a bit about how, where are we getting our funding? Who's running the site? Who are these people? Are they a problem? That sort of thing. So that happened in 2011, and we kind of felt ethically obligated to tell our readers about it. Well, some entirely predictable things happened. You know, people on the hard left who've been in the anti-war movement for many, many years tend to just be more accepting of the fact that COINTELPRO and FBI surveillance happens all the time, and they're sort of blasé about it. To a point where like, yeah, okay, this is real life, this happens. Libertarians tend to just take this paranoid attitude that we're constantly being watched, Yeah, we never go for any real proof of that. We're just, oh my God, they're watching us. They're around there somewhere. But they really were watching us. And what happened was our donor base shrank quite a bit because people get uncomfortable if they're giving to an organization they realize, and it became more and more evident, that was under active FBI surveillance. What happened for us, and we're really, really pleased, is that the ACLU of Northern California took the case and decided in 2012 that they were going to firmly make this an important lawsuit, and antiwar.com is still actively involved in this lawsuit. This is probably going to go on for years. The back and forth has been trying to, the two staff members primarily, or two of our founders, Eric Garrison and Justin Armando, are suing. They just want two things: to stop the surveillance of antiwar.com and for the FBI to release all the files on antiwar.com and the people involved that they have been following. And this has been a back and forth and very, very amusing discussion where stacks of paperwork will come by and entire things are whited out. You get a few cryptic words, a sentence fragment, and more and more has been whited out. So it changed the way people looked at antiwar.com. It gave us a lot of credibility and respectability and a lot of people. On the other hand, lots of different kinds of people give to antiwar.com. It's not just, and I mean, people tend to stereotype antiwar activists as being hippies from the counterculture, which is a very old stereotype. I mean, how many people here know hippies? I mean, you may know hippies, but they're probably parents or grandparents. They're not, you know, kids anymore, so it's a different, lots of different people are against the war for lots of different reasons. And none of this should, by the way, should have been a shock. Both the people who were primarily the focus of the FBI's investigation had been activists since the 70s. Our founder, Eric Garris, got arrested the first time for handing out anti-war leaflets in an Air Force base when he was 17, which was probably 1971, the Peace and Freedom Party days. So his file's actually quite long. And most people who are kind of hip to these things realize that the anti-war movement has always been under investigation, always is. I mean, I was looking up, I mean, very, very heavily beginning probably in World War I, and predates that, but goes all the way to things like the Espionage Act of 1917 or the Sedition Act of 1918, where the government closed newspapers and jailed people for printing anti-war editorials. And that was also later after that was the decade of Smedley Butler, who talks about war as a racket. People were actively questioning about the war. In fact, if you look at the Freedom Information Act vault on the internet, you'll find that there's all kinds of great files now released on people like Howard Zinn, files on Kent State, files on the Quakers, those wacky Quakers, with all their peace stuff. I mean, who the heck knows what they might be up to? Jane Addams, Edward Abbey, and other names you'd recognize. I mean, this is something that's a fact of the anti-war movement. One of the things I've talked about at some libertarian groups, because not as many libertarians are aware of this, but people on the left are. In 2010, the FBI raided homes of anti-war activists and people who were active in the pro-Palestinian movement. And this was in the Chicago and Minneapolis area. And if you ever see the Stop FBI hashtag on Twitter, you'll know that a lot of these things are still actively going on. And when I mean they're under investigation, the FBI raided private houses and took out people's computers out of their houses. These are like people you might be living next door to, and the FBI comes in and sweeps everything out and all the data, which is a very strange thing to have happen to you. I hope it hasn't happened to anyone in here, but I'm sure somebody has a story here that they could tell us that would make our hair curl. There was no basis to the claim in any way that these people were getting support from foreign governments. They were just normal activists. But it's something that the government does, and there are reasons for this. I think philosophically and just my life experience has given me that fighting war, being against war, is basically like being an atheist in the church of the state. War is the biggest thing that the government does. It's the most expensive thing that the government does. It's the most morally questionable thing that the government does. And it's what it means to kind of be an American in 2015 is being support for the empire. I mean, what is an American identity? It means ruling the world, and it all the things that go with that, and it's very distasteful. I mean, if you think of the way people in our political system rally around everything, people can rationalize how Barack Obama wanted to go further into Afghanistan, the good war, and harass an allied country like Pakistan, or claim credit for getting out of Iraq when in fact it was a status of forces agreement, and irrespective of who got elected, we would have been chased out of there. And it's not a Republican or Democratic thing. I mean, who's ever in there is a representative of the war machine. This is not going to change regardless of who's elected. One of the two people who will be elected will continue to administer the empire forever. So it makes absolutely no difference. I'll just mention now that one of the things that's amusing about Bernie Sanders is that if you look at his website, there's not a single mention of foreign policy on there. And as far as Jeb Bush and the others are concerned, it's just a question of how far to the right do people go on the right? All the way to someone like Lindsey Graham, who hasn't quite convinced himself that he can bomb France, I guess, next. So it's a pretty dangerous situation regardless. To me, it's an utter waste of time to go into that voting booth. Whomever you're electing is just somebody who's going to administer the police state or the empire more efficiently, which means perhaps more death. I don't know. I perhaps want less efficiency. So I am not terribly sympathetic to that system. I don't care for that system much. And I certainly don't have any respect for the idea that Americans who engage in journalism should be under any kind of special surveillance. And our case is still ongoing. I just want to also mention that too, that the FBI isn't entirely competent. I mean, the FBI monitored antiwar.com for several reasons, including because they had mistakenly misunderstood a complaint our webmaster had made about someone threatening to hack our site. Now, we don't believe the FBI is really good for much, but we do find that occasionally having a paper trail with the state, if you have a major complaint, might be helpful. So my boss made the mistake of reporting the fact that someone was threatening to hack our site. The FBI agent took this down and interpreted this as the antiwar.com is threatening to hack FBI's sites. Well, that totally makes sense. By the way, this is in The Guardian. Spencer Ackerman reported all on our trials and travails, and you can look up all these things, and a lot of major news outlets covered the story when we found out that we were first being investigated. And you can also find out some really good information from Marcy Wheeler. She's a former Fire Dog Leg blogger who blocked the name MD Wheel. But the case is still ongoing. But it totally destroyed about 20% of our budget. I mean, people pulled back. They stopped giving. They really resisted giving us any more money. They became nervous. I had major donors say, I just really don't want any trouble. And you know, those are people with money. People have something to lose. So it definitely changed how we did things. We cut back even further. We stretched our staff out more, paid everyone even less, cut some jobs out. People working harder, we're getting grouchier, and the Obama administration keeps on pursuing more hot wars. So it was not as if there was any stop in the news cycle. And that made it difficult. And what further made it difficult, and this has happened in the past year, which is also why alternative means of funding are important, were that Google AdSense pulled their account with us. They decided that they no longer wanted to have ads on antiwar.com because they had discovered that we, for 11 years, had been keeping a page on the torture sites where we keep all the pictures up there, all the graphic. Now, we warn people that the pictures, which are highly graphic, are up there. We're one of the few places that's consistently run them, and we are dedicated to keeping those pictures up there. Removing them was never an option. Google AdSense violated its own terms of service with us by not giving the usual 72-hour warning they generally give the webmasters. They just pulled it. Google is very difficult to reach. I'm sure people, I don't want to offend anyone who works there, but Google makes it very, very difficult for you to contact an actual human being who's there. In fact, they even encourage you to use the US mail to come and complain. So that means they don't have a whole lot of confidence in their product. But the tech community seemed to have no patience with this. The tech world is not necessarily a perfect overlap with antiwar.com, But there was enough outrage on Twitter, so much outrage, that I got through our general inbox an email from somebody in Google's PR. And they said, we're really sorry. This is not really, you know, all we want to do is not, you know, this violated our gore and violence policy. Well, we're an anti-war website. I mean, we're not printing pictures of unicorns and rainbows and, you know, happiness and all that. I mean, that wouldn't, it'd be honest to the war. And basically what had happened was they said, fine, we're going to reinstate the ads. And that lasted for 48 hours. And then they decided that articles on Ukraine's recent troubles became a problem. And at that point, we decided we're not going to have Google AdSense go through 10,000 pages, which is roughly what was at antiwar.com back in March of this year, and make our editorial policies or change the way we report things. So that cut our revenue even further. So why Bitcoin? Bitcoin is still a way people can donate with, it's not perfectly anonymous, it's not perfectly private. I realize these things are still complicated, and I know a lot of you out there working on these projects. But for us, Bitcoin is a way of getting around that. It gives us some privacy, but also it's a statement. It's a statement about using the empire's money, or as the young anarchist kids call it, blood money. Now, I still live in the system. I don't live underground. I haven't completely, you know, decided to move to a mini house in New Hampshire yet with a solar power panel or anything, but Bitcoin does mean something to us. And I know the excitement about Bitcoin for a lot of people has gone down. You know, I mean, you know, new things, Bitcoin's changed, the world has changed, it's much more regulated. You read about the Winklevoss brothers and all the different things that have happened, and then the horrible thing that happened with Silk Road. Horrible meaning that hero is now in prison. So I mean, this, you know, I realize that perhaps the initial excitement of Bitcoin has long since passed, but symbolically it's still very important to us. And it's one way that we show resistance to the fact that we're not stopping journalism and we're not stopping our opposition to the state, especially on the empire. And certainly when it comes to war, occupation, and torture, we're certainly not going to stand for that. So basically, yeah, Bitcoin still matters. Still matters to antiwar.com, and I hope it still all matters to you in a few years too. So thank you.
I don't know if there's questions.
You have a QR code we can donate to. Or maybe later.
Yeah, I can show you where it is. I don't have a fancy smartphone.
Okay.
Do you want to answer?
Yeah, I'll answer some questions.
If anyone has questions, we can do that.
What do you think about services like ChangeTip? Have you tried any of those?
We just actually started doing a little bit of that on Twitter to see how people would react to that. And people think it's fun and they like it, so that's hopefully something that with our partnership with Bitcoin Not Bombs, we'll be working with more.
And what's your Twitter address?
Our main Twitter address is antiwarcom, and if you want to harangue me personally, it's just antiwar2.
Or if I want to change it.
Yeah, Tiffany, that's
right. So do you earn Bitcoin donations only, or also?
We'll take just about anything.
Because I was wondering, because you can't use AdSense anymore, so I was wondering if you considered using CoinURL on your website.
Well, you know, we're open to just about anything. Anything that we can sell, maybe not body parts yet, because we know Silk Road has had issues, so we're going to, you know, but we're open. So anything that, any great ideas people have, we're definitely interested.
Could you talk a little more about how Bitcoin could reduce the state's ability to wage war?
Oh, okay. This is the... And I'm not the best person to explain this, but there's a really excellent, very inspirational, almost kind of a tear-jerking speech by Roger Ver online where he talks about why anti-war is this big issue. But basically, you know, we have the Federal Reserve System, we have a current system of banking, and because the government's money isn't tied to anything, it isn't tied to something tangible like gold or silver or even trees or tables or whatnot, the government can just keep printing money indefinitely, and it does. And that is the way war is financed and will continue to be financed. And until we rethink how we do things, war is going to continue, and the wartime economy has not benefited any of us. I know that I'm a lot poorer because of the war, and I think not just poorer financially, but I think poorer morally as a nation, because we do, because war is our focus, and I think we can do better than that.
Would you think the military actually has developed a lot of really good technologies for the community as well?
Yeah, but the military isn't the only thing that can develop technologies, nor is NASA. There's lots of people in this room who would rather, do anything but serve in the military, who come up with great ideas every day. So I would rather skip the military's aspect, and there are people who'd make the argument that actually it's kind of suppressed, not because of any conspiracy, just because it's a large bureaucracy that has no incentives. Incentives matter to people, and without those incentives, why would you spend any time doing research and development? So I guess that would be my...
I'd rather have less technology and less dead people. Like, I'm not willing to trade killing somebody for fancy technology.
The Nazis built great technology.
Yeah. I think that sums it all up right there. All right. Well, thank you all very much, and I'll be around. And
cool. Thanks, Angela. All right. So next up, we'll jump right into it. Rainey Reitman from EFF is going to be speaking on general financial censorship and Bitcoin regulation. And if you want to sign up for a lightning talk, there's a list back there. We think there's only a couple people signed up so far. So on that table in the middle by the flowers.
And what's your Twitter handle?
My Twitter handle is Rainey Reitman. Should I spell that?
No.
Okay. EFF's Twitter handle is EFF. Okay, can we give it up for Paige? Paige is like amazing. Thank you, Paige. I have been trying to get to this meetup group forever. When did you contact me? Like a year ago or something. It was forever. And it meets at the same time as another meetup group that I'm in. And then I found out it was Paige's last time running it. And I was like, no, I'm going to do everything to be there. I will definitely show up. So thank you for putting these amazing events together. You're an inspiration. You're awesome, Paige, and I'm glad I get to be here. So that's done. I'm Rainey Reitman. I'm with the Electronic Frontier Foundation. Who has heard of EFF? Raise your hand. Okay, there's at least 5 people here who haven't heard of EFF, so they get to find out about us. EFF is a nonprofit organization that deals with technology and civil liberties issues. So we deal with everything from free speech online to fighting back against mass surveillance to fighting back against not mass surveillance to fighting for individual privacy on the internet. We deal with breaking new innovation issues. We have defended hackers. We have defended people trying to hack their smart calculators. We are really interested in how, as we move into these new worlds of ever-increasing, ever more digital lives, we maintain all those basic constitutional values that we had in our offline spaces. And in fact, ideally, we have even more rights and even more freedoms than we had previously. So basically, using technologies to advance both constitutional rights and human rights. We used to be primarily an impact litigation firm. That's how we got started. So basically, our attorneys would go out and would find court cases and then basically try to advocate for constitutional rights in order to affect the law. And in fact, we represent a number of Bitcoin-related clients who are doing innovation in the space. That's not my bailiwick. That's not what I work on. I work on the advocacy side of things, which means I try to stop laws before they get put into place. I try to beat back bad laws. I try to advance good laws. And I also try to affect company policies by writing blog posts and running a team of advocates and running advocacy campaigns. We also have a technology team. And I think one of our technologists came a few months ago, Joseph Bonneau, who is amazing and is writing a textbook on Bitcoin and is just fantastic, and I hope he sticks around forever. So that's a little bit about EFF. And then my background, before I came to EFF, I was a consumer advocate. I worked just on privacy, but I worked on non-digital digital privacy, and I've been at EFF for about 5 years now. So from SOPA to NSA spying, it's been a crazy, beautiful ride, and I'm very glad to be there. And today I'm going to talk about kind of two completely different things, but sort of related, but I wanted to talk about them both, so I'm just going to do it. And one is financial censorship, which is just how they are using pressure by credit card companies to shut down free speech online and the ramifications of that. And also a bill that is moving through the California legislature known as AB 1326, because I have you here and I want to talk about it. So with that in mind, can somebody volunteer to be a little bit of a timekeeper for me?
I will.
Okay. Can you, like, give me a nod at 10 minutes and a nod at 15 minutes and a nod at 20 minutes just so I have a sense of what's happening, like a wave?
Sure.
Okay, yeah. Great. So financial censorship. I got interested in this issue actually through work that wasn't related to EFF. So taking off my little EFF hat for a second and going to what I do in my spare time, I'm heavily involved with an organization called the Chelsea Manning Support Network. And back in 2010, I helped to get this organization started. It was known at the time as the Bradley Manning Support Network, and it is an organization that advocates for the WikiLeaks whistleblower who is currently serving in prison for releasing many, many documents to WikiLeaks that also shed light on a lot of things related to our international policies and our wars, and also, among many other things, included a video that showed American soldiers gunning down journalists overseas. So I became very interested in her case, very compelled by the video, and helped work with a group of advocates around the world who I had never met in setting up a defense fund on her behalf and working to push for her freedom. And so that was what I was doing in my spare time, totally different from my EFF work. And one day, our accounts got shut down. Our PayPal account got frozen. And this was a very frustrating experience for us because PayPal was the number one way that people outside of the United States were donating to Chelsea's defense fund. It was necessary for us to get donations from around the world. And we began engaging with PayPal and we said, look, PayPal, the organization, this specific project is brand new, but the organization has had a PayPal account because we were umbrellaed under another organization for like 6 years and you've never had a problem with this. Why have you frozen our account? And I was able to escalate it through some contacts I had to sort of their top level services, but no matter what I did, they kept saying, no, it's federal regulations. We need you to give us all this additional information. We need you to give us access to your parent organization's bank account so that we can withdraw money without your consent. And we were like, we literally can't do that. And they were like, we don't have a choice. It's federal regulation. You have to let us do this. So we decided to launch a PR campaign. We put out a press release, we made a huge stink about it, and a ton of newspapers and online magazines picked it up and started writing about it. And we had, within 24 hours of us initially writing about it, PayPal caved. They just reinstated our accounts. And this was an enormous wake-up call for me, because I realized that all those things that they had said about, oh, it's a federal regulation, we have to have this, and oh, it's our hands are tied, we don't have an opportunity to do anything, were complete nonsense. It was an arbitrary policy, perhaps based or related to something in law, but not necessarily a strict interpretation of it, and it was arbitrarily enforced, which meant that they could choose when they wanted to enforce it, and they could choose not to enforce it at will. And so this was my first foray into what I later have sort of developed as financial censorship issues, which are the ways that organizations like the Chelsea Manning Support Network, but like many other organizations, are getting forced to change what they publish or change the projects that they run or shut down entirely because they're afraid that they won't be able to receive the funds that they need in order to survive. I think that the basis of this, like sort of the core of the problem, if we were going to boil it down, is that most financial transactions currently go through Visa and MasterCard, and those two companies work extremely closely together, and they sort of have mimicked policies that allow them to decide what kind of things they will and won't allow to be have financial processes for. And they also work very closely with law enforcement. We now know that there is a operation known as Operation Choke Point. Are you guys familiar with it? Anybody? A couple of you. So Operation Choke Point is basically a program, not just of the Department of Justice, but of a number of different law enforcement agencies that is putting pressure on financial companies like Visa and MasterCard, like banks, like financial processors, and all sorts of other financial intermediaries to basically police certain types of speech and police certain types of organizations and provide information to the government or shut down accounts entirely. And the government uses this mechanism. They pressure the financial companies when they can't go after the companies directly. So they use this tool when the organization that they're going after hasn't done anything illegal and you can't just go out and get a warrant and take down their site, or you can't go after them directly. And so instead, you're putting pressure on the financial company. And if a financial company refuses to comply, first of all, let's face it, they don't normally refuse to comply because these are financial companies, and that's not what they do. And also because they will face fines from the government. So even though the government can't directly go after the organization that they might want to go after, they'll be able to put fines onto the financial service provider if the financial service provider doesn't assist them. And we've seen banks and financial companies writing about this, but it's fairly shrouded in secrecy, the details of who the targets of this campaign are and, you know, what the ramifications of it are. We have seen a few specific examples of what financial censorship looks like and exactly how that affects online speech. And the most obvious one, the one everybody thinks about, is WikiLeaks. WikiLeaks, to date, has not been charged in the United States with a crime. Visa and MasterCard and PayPal and I think it was a Bank of America, who was the bank? And a bank, all shut down WikiLeaks because they disagreed with what WikiLeaks published. They thought even though WikiLeaks, by publishing documents that they had passively received from a whistleblower, had not itself violated the law, that you might make some crazy argument about the Espionage Act, I would debate that would be inaccurate, but because that they had not actually violated the law, the government couldn't go after WikiLeaks directly, they were able to put pressure on financial services to shut them down. And as a result of that, WikiLeaks suffered a financial hardship of incredible proportions. They lost, they would say, hundreds of thousands of dollars. You can actually look, which I did not make slides, but you could imagine a slide of their of their financial transactions. Wow, look at those donations, and then boom, they get shut down, and then there's nothing. How can they possibly survive? It's terrible. So in some ways, I mean, I'm very concerned about WikiLeaks. In some ways, I'm much more concerned about the organizations that we don't all know the name of, the companies and the organizations who might be doing something, maybe something that you think isn't even that great, maybe something that you personally disagree with or you wouldn't personally do, but which is completely 100% legal. These are the companies that, in my mind, are most at danger right now because they don't have a really strong story and they aren't getting a lot of public attention. The nice thing about WikiLeaks is they're very good at getting a lot of public attention. They've really nailed that. And as a result, even though they suffered this terrible financial hardship, they were still able, through other means, including the nonprofit Freedom of the Press Foundation, to get donations in through other means. So in some ways, they're not exactly the perfect scenario for describing financial censorship. Are you guys familiar with the, it's like a website and it's an online publisher called Smashwords? Here's one that you guys didn't know. So Smashwords is an online publisher. It was started by a guy who wrote a book, and then he went around and he tried to find a publisher to publish his book, and nobody would publish it. And he was like, this is a tragedy. I need to make sure that people read this book. And so he started an entire, like, huge company that helps authors self-publish their books. And it's now, I believe, one of the absolute largest companies for authors to self-publish their books so that you don't have to have somebody tell you whether or not your book's good. You can just go out there, you can sell it, people can buy it, you get paid directly. You get paid through PayPal. And so they don't police the fiction and the writing that goes up on their site. People can write about pretty much anything, but it's written words. So we're not talking about pictures here. We're talking about written words by people, And what happened was they got in some hot water from, I think it was initially PayPal. PayPal went after them because they felt that some of the content on their site might violate the brand protection obligations that PayPal had with Visa and MasterCard. And Visa and MasterCard have these moralistic components to their brand protection agreements that include things related to, you can't have content that's related to, I think it's incest, bestiality, and rape. Which, all horrible things, we can all agree about that. But also, all things that are occasionally written about in fiction, right? For better or for worse, there are very complicated, very difficult things that people will write about and explore. And what happened was Smashwords basically faced an entire shutdown of their entire site unless they would implement a policy where they weren't going to allow books to be published on their site unless they could promise not, is it 10 minutes? Okay. Unless they could promise not to have any of these controversial topics in them, which would knock out like a whole bunch of Greek mythology right there. And, So this was terrible, and what ended up happening was all of these authors started speaking out, including authors who were themselves victims of rape, who had gone on to write about their experiences and publish their own books and said, this is terrible, this is actually how I processed this, and I want my story to get out. Why is it impossible for me to write my fiction stories? Because they were primarily fiction stories. And we were able, again, because I'd done this before, we were able to launch a publicity campaign and draw attention to this case. We had a coalition letter. And we were able to get PayPal to reinstate Smashwords and to reinstate and to actually change their policies so they'd be slightly more speech friendly. And I went down and I met with the general counsel of PayPal. And I was like, this is terrible. And he told me, it's not a policy I would want, which I don't know if that's true, but he said it's because Visa and MasterCard have these components to their agreements with us. And if I get shut off by Visa and MasterCard, PayPal is in a really terrible bind. Like we really need to maintain our relationship there. Which kind of made me hone in back on the fact that basically Visa and MasterCard are getting to decide what kind of writing and fiction are getting published by authors who didn't even go through a publisher or are publishing it themselves. And that, to me, was an amount of control that I think is absolutely inappropriate for two major financial services company, especially because we don't really have a lot of options. If even PayPal is dependent on Visa and MasterCard, then all of the other financial service providers like Stripe and everybody else are, to a certain extent, beholden to the terms and conditions that are set up by Visa and MasterCard, who are these behemoths in the space that you can't really fight. And then the other one that I'm dealing with right now is Backpage.com. So Backpage.com does a lot of things. For example, you can buy an old refrigerator on Backpage.com, or you could maybe sublet an apartment, or there's a section where you could find adult services for massage or an escort. That's a known fact. Everybody knows this. And if you didn't know that, now you know, if you were curious. One of the things is that there is a sheriff in Cook County known as Sheriff Dodd who is very upset at Backpage.com. He thinks that it is inappropriate and that them allowing these types of services on their sites will result in human trafficking. Even though Backpage goes out of their way to work with law enforcement and actually goes through identity verification for the people using the adult services section of their site and has really gone above and beyond to try to police these sorts of things. Nonetheless, Sheriff Dodd is angry and he's tried to go after Backpage.com to get them to take down this section of the website. But it turns out that he can't effectively pursue them because we have a First Amendment, which protects free speech online, and nothing they were posting or hosting is actually illegal. They are passive providers of the content, and they've already cooperated with law enforcement. And the end result was that Sheriff Dodd has now put pressure on Visa and MasterCard, writing a letter to them saying, if you care about children, you should shut down Backpage.com. And all of a sudden, Backpage is in a real bind, because while they could easily fight Sheriff Dodd if he went after them directly, it's much harder for them to fight Visa and MasterCard. And so right now we're seeing the situation, and this is in some ways a less sympathetic character than WikiLeaks or Smashwords, that this is a website that many people don't like or are big fans of, but at the end of the day hasn't violated the law and is still suffering financial censorship by these big online financial behemoths.
Except Bitcoin.
Yeah.
Yeah. So all of this is leading up to the wow, isn't Bitcoin such an amazing thing? maybe I'll just jump to it since I'm already 10 minutes. So all of which is me getting up to Bitcoin for me is interesting because it has the opportunity to completely disrupt this horrible duopoly that we have with Visa and MasterCard.
15 minutes.
If it were widespread and if it were being widely used, we would have the opportunity to route around censorship, whether it's Visa and MasterCard, whether it's Smashwords, whether it's Backpage, whether it's something that you completely agree with or something you totally disagree with. You'd have the opportunity to basically be your own bank and not let somebody else decide whether or not something is or isn't appropriate content for you to be reading or accessing. This would be your choice, not Visa and MasterCard's choice. And one of the things that I think we need to think about in the coming years as a community is, to what extent will the very large Bitcoin companies begin to adopt the same exact principles and tendencies that Visa and MasterCard have adopted? Were they lean towards, I'm assuming that whatever the joke was, he was with me, not against me. Where they lean towards basically collecting more data on users than they need to, or shutting down accounts arbitrarily, or handing data over to the government when they don't actually have to. And so these are the types of things I think we should be looking to avoid in the Bitcoin space as long as possible, or perhaps forever, and that we should, when possible, look to decentralize and look to ensure that Bitcoin continues to be a liberty-enhancing technology and not something that undermines our basic online freedoms. And I'm now going to switch topics, boom, totally switched, to AB 1326. This is a bill in California that is moving very fast right now. And it's a bill that would force California virtual currency services to obtain a license. Most people are probably familiar. I'm seeing some head nods. This is a bill that is very problematic for me in a couple of ways. On a philosophical level, I think that right now is the wrong time to push a Bitcoin regulation through because Bitcoin is still relatively new and the technology is changing so quickly. As some of you may know, back in 1986, we passed a law to protect email privacy. But because email was brand new, it had big technical inaccuracies that were put into law, and even though it was supposed to protect people, today, literally today, I am fighting to make sure that law enforcement has to get a warrant if your emails are more than 6 months old. And if we had waited a little bit longer, it's possible that the technology around email would have developed, or we would have at least had a better sense of where it was going. We would have realized that people were going to keep emails for more than 6 months, and we'd have made sure that when we put in warrant protections for them, that they extended for longer than 6 months. So I'm worried because Bitcoin is, in many ways, moving much more quickly than email was back in 1986. And if we move so fast that we develop even what some people think might be forward-thinking laws around virtual currency services, we might inadvertently lock us into a moment in time that we're going to be regretting 5 or 10 or 15 years from now, or 25 years from now. And the other reason is this bill that's moving through California right now, AB 1326, is being promoted as a model bill. So they want to move it in here, and then they want to put it in every state across the country. And I frankly am not convinced that the best way to regulate virtual currencies is on state-by-state licenses, that every single company that wants to have an interaction with anyone in any state is going to have to get a license in each of those states. I don't see how that won't hurt the community and hurt us long-term.
Helps banks,
and it helps very large established Bitcoin companies. But if we wanted, even if you're okay with both of those things, even if you're like, well, sure, state-by-state, right now, seems okay to me. Even if you're okay with both of those things, I would urge you to have hesitations about AB 1326, because it's technically inaccurate. I'm running out of time, so I'm not going to describe everything, but it describes, so let me think of one example. It describes, it often describes people who have control. That's one of their technical terms, and they don't define what that means. But in the Bitcoin space, it's a little hard to know who they're referring to, like who has control in that sense. And they also have, they refer to services that are in the state, but it's also tricky to know, well, when is a service in the state and when is it not? Even their definition of virtual currency services is very vague. So it has like technical inaccuracies, but even if it were technically accurate, it's Bitcoin specific, which means all of your new types of currencies that are moving more quickly, Litecoin or whatever, are currencies that might fall a little bit outside of what the regulation is designed to affect. And the currencies that haven't been developed yet, that might come down the road in like 5 years, are definitely going to be outside of what this was designed to encapsulate. So I'm very nervous about that for that reason. I'm also nervous because in order to get one of these licenses, you have to apply to the Commissioner of Business Oversight, and he can reject you for any reason at all, and he can also wait 2 years to decide to reject you, and there's no due process. So if you get rejected, you don't have an appeal process in order to get a license. There have been adjustments to the bill that made it slightly better, but it's still just a rotten bill. Like, it just is full of technical inaccuracies and deeply problematic. And what concerns me perhaps most of all is that there are a handful of about four big Bitcoin companies who would not be affected by the law, who think it's totally fine and are lobbying for it. Because they're part of the exceptions, they have written their own exception that would affect them. So, you have a question, and I'm going to stop and I'm going to answer your question.
Sorry, I'm just wondering if you could name the four companies.
I'm not going to, because I feel like that is a jerk move.
Why? They're being jerks.
Okay. Okay, so I would urge you guys to look. The main body lobbying for it is Coin Center. Go look and see who's backing them. Sorry, what's your question?
So, pursuant to Coin Center, so the position Jared Brito's put across is that already Bitcoin companies are under existing financial regulations, subject to interpretation of the regulators.
Right.
The regulators will decide to interpret as they will, but there's a lot of uncertainty around how they might interpret these. And this is attempting to at least create some clarity, whether we like it or not, but attempting to create clarity around the issue of how those Bitcoin companies would.
That's totally what Jerry thinks. Jerry and I have had a long conversation about this. Jerry thinks better the demon that you know than the demon you don't know, and what if California suddenly started trying to go after Bitcoin companies using existing financial laws? And the answer is, A, California isn't doing that, and the Department of Business Oversight has specifically said that they will wait to do that until such time as the legislature moves, or perhaps even longer. They have nothing drafted. We have no examples of anything they've produced. And B, I just don't believe that A, we can't get anything better, or B, we should rush to the slaughter. That in the face of a lack of regulation, we should try to be like, it's inevitable, let's go for it now. When literally, if we can push this thing off a year or two, which is completely possible, it would be so simple to push this off to a 2-year bill and possibly delay it beyond that we couldn't end up with either something better or at least something that's more reflective of the direction the Bitcoin community is headed. So Jerry and I have this, and I like him, and I think he's super smart. He's great. He's great, and I'm surprised that we disagree on this one. But he also, I think that organization represents very large established Bitcoin companies who already went through their crazy startup phase. And as a result, they've got a system in place to navigate the complexities of a new regulatory proposal. And frankly, they could take on getting 50 different licenses. So. All of that leads me to you have a question. I'm going to stop and answer.
On that regulatory issue in California, what are some of the most effective things that people in the room could do to help that?
I'm so glad you asked. So there's a couple of things. The number one thing, and the thing I really need, and the reason I'm really here, is because we are writing a coalition letter to the state of California and telling them to slow down. say, you have not had one hearing where you actually got to hear from Bitcoin experts describing how the technology works, before you enact this law, stop and hear from the Bitcoin community. And we're asking them to address the technical inaccuracies of the bill, and we're telling them if they don't address these things, please don't pass it. So it's a very reasonable thing. I think even Jerry couldn't complain with this. So you might be. I haven't published it yet. So what I'm really looking for, and Perse actually just signed on, is to get Bitcoin companies or companies that have a relationship with Bitcoin or any virtual currency or who accept virtual currency. Internet Archive just signed on. Please, I need to move this letter this week because this bill could be taken up on Monday. So if there's any chance that you're interested, I brought some write-ups of the bill. I brought my card. I'm going to put it in the back. Don't wait to call me. Call me immediately. I really want to talk to you. We need to move this quickly. The other thing we're going to do is we're going to have a, we're running an email campaign so people can email their state senators. We have already hit every single state senator, but we want to keep hitting them again and again. And then next week, we're going to have a call-in campaign. You enter your information, and it connects you to your state senator. And we will be announcing that on the EFF blog. And I also just tweeted right before I started talking a link on the EFF Twitter account that you can read about this bill. So if you're interested, please share the information about the bill. Please talk about it. Please tell other people about it. And please, if there's any way you or your organization can get involved, I really need people to get involved between now and September 11th. This is go time for stopping this bill. I've got two questions. Should I stop? I'm over time.
You can answer questions.
Okay. yes, what's up?
Who are the big lobbying forces behind it?
So at this point, Coin Center is the main lobbying force behind it, and the Internet Association, which I think is tragic. You had a question, sir.
Yeah, why did it take so long? John Lyke started the change.org petition 7 days after AB 1326 passed the assembly, urging them to withdraw it, and that was in February. Why did it take the EFF until August to come out against it?
So, the truth is that we started having conversations with the author to try to affect the bill. And we
did too.
Yeah, so we tried to do that, and my understanding at the time from our lobbyists in Sacramento that it was more effective to do that initially than to try to do a big full frontal attack on it. And I felt like we did make some progress, but then we stopped making any progress at all. And that's when we turned to our big, huge attack on it much more publicly. I regret not coming out against it earlier. I think that was a mistake, and I'm apologizing to you guys as a community. I messed up. We should have come out sooner. And part of it was we were waiting because we thought we'd make changes. Part of it was I was short-staffed and I didn't have enough time. And those are not decent excuses, either of them, but those are honestly what happened. So we should have come out sooner, but we still have time to fight this thing. The author is trying to do something to yank it out of committee. It just got pulled back to committee, and he's trying to bypass process to move it more quickly to get it through the legislature by September 11th, which means we've got a really solid chance of stopping him. So those are the things I wanted to talk to you guys about. Thank you. I'm going to leave my card on the back table with, I have about 10 printouts of a blog post about the bill. Take my card. If my card's not there, my email is Rainey, R-A-I-N-E-Y, at EFF.org. Please email me if you're interested. Thank you.
Great, thanks, Rainey. So I think we're just gonna not do any announcements because there aren't any, other than I guess it's my last event as organizer. So thanks for coming. And we're gonna do the lightning talks.
Ooh, right.
So whoever signed up for a lightning talk, please perhaps line up over here. And how many do we have?
Four.
So if there's six more people that want to do a lightning talk, you can hop on. Ready?
Yeah. Okay.
Hi everybody, my name is Sunny. Thanks for all being here. So I just wanted to say that what that lady was saying earlier at the beginning, the anti-war lady, so about 3 or 4 years ago, I could really identify with everything she was saying, and I really got tired of being against things, and it was just really, it just felt like a heavy anvil on my shoulder. And so when I discovered Bitcoin, it was an opportunity for me to actually stand for something instead of just be against it. And that's why I'm a big believer in Bitcoin. I helped found the leading Bitcoin company in India. The name of our company is Uno Coin. My wife's from Colombia, hence the Uno. And we're kind of the, we consider Coinbase to be the Uno Coin of America. But anyways, we make it easy for people in India to buy and sell Bitcoin online. And I only have about 15 seconds left, but anybody have any questions?
Can we use it from the United States?
No, you cannot. It's only for people in India. But if you have Bitcoin, you can send Bitcoins to people in India. So just a couple of points really quickly. So India, people in India love gold. Women in India have more gold than the US government and the next three governments after it. So Bitcoin's very exciting for that reason. Number two, India is the biggest inward remitter in the world, $70 billion a year. Number three, Bitcoin, so India has the biggest unbanked population in the world, and we think for those three reasons Bitcoin's exciting.
Hi, good evening everyone. My name is Xinxi, I'm from Singapore, and we are doing a Bitcoin options exchange, so you can buy or sell options on Bitcoins in this exchange. You know, right now the price of Bitcoin is dropping very fast. So if you have some Bitcoins, you are in very high risk. And we provide options for you to hedge your risk. Yeah, that's all. Thanks.
Hi everyone, I'm Jinyoung from Changetip, and I'm here to share our marketing campaign currently going on with Direct Relief, which is one of the top charities in the world. It is the chance to show the power of Bitcoin for good causes. For people who think that Bitcoin is a sketchy drug, illegal internet money, no it's not. It can do something to good, do something good like this for saving mothers in Africa. So $5 buys a bottle of vitamin. I know you guys are not really happy with the current price of Bitcoin. It has been a little bit fluctuating for over a few days. But every bit helps, and we would love your contribution. You can you can go to this website, directrelief.org/Bitcoin. You can Google it. You can donate by QR code, wallet address, or you can definitely donate by Changetip. Thanks.
Mine will be a little different. I'm Matt, I'm a political philosopher, and this will be hopefully a 1 minute political philosophy rant. I wanted to talk a little about the anti-war comment stuff and just dive into the structure. Humans have two tools for coercing others to behave the way we want them to. One is violence, which I will define as an attack on the body or a restraint of the body. The other is access control. So somebody turning towards you or turning away from you, right? You gaining access to a resource or losing access to a resource. And these two are both really coercive, right? If the entire community turns away from you, it could amount to death, right? But they operate in a very different way in one sense. Violence is binary. Because violence acts on the body, when you enforce it, when you enact it, you actually attack the body. The community has to come to a consensus about the norm. Right? Is it illegal to be gay? Is it illegal to steal? Is it illegal to operate a Bitcoin exchange without filing all the right paperwork or what, et cetera? Access control doesn't force that disagreement. One person can turn away, one can turn towards. And I think a lot of the tools that the people in this room are building are powerful because they can enable us to do regulation at the scales at which we operate today, global scale, amidst disagreement, because they enable us to do access control-based regulation. Thank you.
We've got six more minutes.
Yeah. I could have burned six more minutes?
No, it's per person. Minute per person. All right.
I'm going to take over. Just for a second.
Okay.
You already got two rounds of applause. I'm going to give you a third one. I think I speak for everybody over here that you've been amazing at creating this community here. We've been doing this for a year and a half together. We've built this community from a little less than 1,000 people to over 2,400, 2,500 people in a year and a half. And we are pretty unlikely duo, I would say. So Andrew, who started this meetup in 2011, I came to the to my first meetup about 2 years ago, and after a couple of meetups, he asked me like, "Do you have any recommendations?" And I'm like, "Oh, I have a ton of ideas how we can improve it," and apparently Paige had the same thoughts. So Andrew ended up moving away, and Paige and I took over, and it's been great and amazing to do this together. We've been on the same page a lot of times, and in some instances, and that's what I really loved about you. You challenge people, and you challenge me, but also the speakers that come up here, whether are there the people that do the talks, the panelists, or the people that do the lightning talks. You really try to challenge people. And I think therefore you get the best out of people, and we're gonna miss you. I'm very happy with the new two team members over here, Tom and Travis, but we'll hope to see you around. And even though you're not gone yet, I know you have some plans, whether it's traveling, moving, chilling. So we thought of giving you a gift. But it's difficult because you're not super attached to like things. So it was a challenge. So we bought you something that could help with the traveling part, but you can also exchange it. So you can do whatever you want with it. So one more big round of applause for Paige. Thank you, Paige.
The gifts, right? You don't have to. I'm not.
Hey, thanks!
They want to see. They want to see? Okay, there you go.
Just like a nice little
bow.
Yeah.
Yes, yeah, so cute.
I mean, if you don't want to see, you don't have to watch. But there's beer in the back end.
Yeah, there's beer.
Bring back some scotch.
Cool, that's really cool. I'm going to use this.
And it's actually for two.
Someone
else is going to be on page.